ऑनरेबल चेयरमैन कोल इंडिया लिमिटेड श्री अनिल कुमार झा जी, इट्स अ हिस्टोरिक मोमेंट फॉर दिस डिपार्टमेंट दैट पायोनियर्ड माइनिंग इंजीनियरिंग एजुकेशन इन इंडिया एंड फॉर द इंस्टीट्यूट दैट इज सर्विंग द नेशन सिंस 1990 एंड व्हेन वी गॉट कन्वर्टेड एज इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी ऑन 29 जून 2012, we became the youngest IIT serving the country with largest period of time. So we were oldest IIT with youngest brain. So with that combination, this department pioneered mining engineering education in India way back in 1923. We continued to deliver first doctorate degree in 1964. The first doctorate degree of India in mining engineering was awarded from this department. Way back in 1964, the degree was obtained by Professor B.S. Verma, who again initiated many of the mining engineering departments, namely Raipur and Rourkela. So this department has always, again, the lead was maintained. In 1966, we were again the first to go for MSc in coal mining and metal mining. In 1972, when Coal India was going to be formed, coal mining was to be nationalized. It was our alumnus, Mr. Chari, who chaired the committee that recommended nationalization of coal mining in India. Chari Saab was again entrusted with the responsibility to go for privatization of coal mining 20 years later. So the alumni of this department have made immense contribution to coal mining landscape in India and also abroad. Now today, it's not that we only played part in history. We continued to be relevant and contemporary. We were one of the first departments to realize that mining to stay scientific and continue contributing in a contemporary way in current world, we need to first adopt numerical modeling. So we introduced numerical modeling in mining way back in 80s. ISM and IIT Kharagpur followed it thereafter. They also took our syllabi, and many of the professors of those two departments learned the ABC of numerical modeling at this place. So our PG students contributed at NIRB, at SIMPER, and many of the scientists of SIMPER and NIRB learned the ABC of scientific understanding and processes in this premises. So with that satisfaction, I am just going to give you a brief about our institute. Indian Institute of Technology today is taking 1100 graduates per year for its BTech and IDD course. The MTech level is about 450 per annum. So at any point of time, we have about 6,000 students involved at BTech and MTech. So we are contributing at a scale on a contemporary level to the human resource development of technology in India. We have also seen today that we have about 1,000 PhD students. The technical prowess of a country is known by the number of PhDs produced by any nation. So a single institute today is having roughly a scale of 1,000 students per annum as research scholar. Sorry, the population of research scholars today in the institute is of the order of 1,000. So you have about 7,000 students on campus in a year today at this institute. We are one of the institutions who also hosts a model mine within its own campus. Because we are situated a bit far from the mining industry, we do not enjoy the freedom and the advantage that ISM has. Scooter pe hame batate hain log ki scooter pe baith ke mine ghoom ke aa sakta hai ISM ka student or faculty. Wo liberty mujhe nahi hai. Nearest mines are open cast, which takes 5 hours one way. So we have a model mine where we can experiment. And recently, we have signed an MOU with Northern Coalfield Limited as its knowledge partner to continue to be relevant to mining industry. It's a big mechanism, and I welcome on behalf of the department, on behalf of the student institute, and in Kashi, Chandrasekhar has already told the relevance of Kashi, our lead speaker of today, Mr. Anil Kumar Jha. We have equally illustrious person on dais, Mr. Prabhat Kumar Sinha, Chairman cum Managing Director, Northern Coalfield Limited. The name itself is so magnanimous and I'll say majestic that the day he has joined, they are making records. And they have produced the production of Northern Coalfield Limited today, particularly on 25th March and 26th March, was off the record. They have achieved their target much before. So we must congratulate him and his team for it. Now today, we have, I told you that we continue to stay. I'm sorry, I think I misnamed Mr. Ajay Kumar Jha, sir, Anil Kumar Jha, sir. Okay. I'm sorry for it. I'm saying that we continue to be relevant with the time, and now it's the time for Industry 4.0. The institute has today picked up the basic building blocks of Industry 4.0, and as an institute, we are training now on Internet of Things, Big Data Analytics, Robotics, Artificial Intelligence, Artificial Reality, Augmented Reality, Virtual Reality, and so that the manpower, or it is better to call today, manpower is not a politically correct word anymore, because we have 8 women candidates in first year of mining engineering. So next generation of technocrats cannot call manpower. So human resources today has to be well versed with Industry 4.0. So we are now geared up for it. We have our faculty members, our research scholars working on these aspects of Industry 4.0. And very soon, when you take our new next batches, they will be well versed in this augmented reality, artificial intelligence. And those of you who are not able to appreciate, today, Google Mail is advising you every time what will be the next word. And that advice comes from your inputs. So the language itself is so well attuned to your uses of words that it becomes suggestive. Similarly, augmented reality can make your diagnostics and predictive tools much more accurate. You can then tap this to better industry. And sir, the industry will then be more competent to serve the society, which is our ultimate aim. I would also like to mention the biggest challenge that educational landscape, particularly in the field of technology, is facing today. Dell did a study and it says that in 2030, the professions that will be required in 2030 for the civilization to operate are not even deciphered. 70% of the professions that will be required to operate in 2030 are not known to the whole world. All the professions and the knowledge systems that we are creating are only populating 30% of the professions that will operate in 2030. So 70% of the professions need to be refigured out. And that is the challenge of the educational landscape. There is the area of the research. What kind of professions are required? So we need to totally reorient ourselves. The industries of tomorrow, I'll give you more common thing. It is said that a single American soldier today has the competence to defeat whole of the Roman Empire. So that's the scale of change. So similarly, technology of tomorrow will be such that in 2030, we might not require much human resources. We might have more number of robotics. To put into numbers, a single robot substitutes 6 people. If you deploy one robot, 6 manpower or human resources lost. So the scale of obsolescence is also knocking at our door. And the only thing that can make us relevant, keep us competent, is to continuously improve on our own self, on our performance, on our stakeholders' credentials, and we should try to improvise each individual who is associated with us so that the system is able to respond to the needs of tomorrow's industry and the society. Thank you very much, and I again welcome each of you.
Thank you, sir. Now may I request our chief guest, Sri Anil Kumar Jha, Chairman, Coal India Limited, to address this August gathering. Sri A.K. Jha.
The man who comes to speak in the last should speak the least. So I will restrict myself. बट एक दो बातें ज़रूर बताना चाहूँगा मैं अपना फॉर्मल एड्रेस देने के पहले. सबसे पहले तो प्रोफेसर शर्मा को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ. उन्होंने बहुत सारी बातें बताई जो मुझे भी मालूम नहीं है. दूसरी बात मैं आपको ये बताना चाहता हूँ कि आप में से हर एक विद्यार्थी जो यहाँ पे बैठा हुआ है, ही इज़ कॉम्पिटेंट एनफ, ही इज़ कैपेबल एनफ टू बिकम चेयरमैन कोल इंडिया, टू बिकम सेक्रेटरी कोल. केवल अपॉर्चुनिटी देने की बात है, केवल अपॉर्चुनिटी देने की बात है. आई कैन साइट यू माई एग्जाम्पल. आई बिलोंग टू ए वेरी मिडिल क्लास फैमिली. माई ग्रैंड फादर वॉज ए फार्मर, माई फादर वॉज एन पुलिस ऑफिसर. We always used to travel here and there. I never got an opportunity to go to a good school. When I did my matriculation in 1976, that was from a very remotest part of Jharkhand. And I got admission in St. Javier's College, Ranchi. For the first time, I could go to a good college. But the very first day I attended my college, that very first day, I wrote a letter to my father that I am not competent enough to study in this college. I cannot speak good English. I cannot understand what professors are teaching. So please take me from this college. I am not competent to study in this college. That time, that was the standard of Ranchi St. Javier's College. I still remember my mathematics professor, Professor Ghatwari. He used to come speaking English and he used to leave the classroom speaking English. And we couldn't understand anything. Then my father came. We both went to our head of the department physics, Professor Brower. Professor Brower, am I clear to all of you? Am I audible properly? Then Professor Brower took me to his chamber and then he told me, please wait for 3 months. After 3 months, everything will be fine and you will see that you are in the front row. And to tell you the truth, after 3 months, the scenario changed. That is why I am very much convinced that, and I am very proud to say you that we have learnt a lot from him. My friend, Mr. P.M. Prasad, Director Technical PNP, two illustrious students from this institute, Mr. Manoj Prasad, General Manager Khadia, going to be Director Technical South Eastern Coalfields Limited. Mr. J.P. Duvedi, working as General Manager in NCL, he is also selected to take higher responsibility. Other dignitaries in front of me, and last but not the least, my dearest students, I am very happy to be with you. I cannot express my happiness. I am going back in flashback 40 years ahead when I used to be a student like you. I used to sit just like you in Penman Auditorium of Indian School of Mines, Dhanbad. There is a auditorium in Indian School of Mines, Dhanbad, by the name of Penman Auditorium. Just like you, I used to sit in that Penman Auditorium, and I used to feel when the time will come, when I will become a person who will go to the dais and who will speak. The time has come, and that time can come to each one of you. Only thing is that you should get the proper opportunity, and you should harvest that opportunity. It's really a pleasure for me. I feel really very proud. I'm really very much privileged, and I really feel proud that Mokshadayini Kasi and Jeevandayini Ganga ke prangan mein, BHU ke prangan mein, main aaj yahan pe aaya hoon aur aap logon ko address kar raha hoon. It is really a very proud moment for me. Friends, you are all aware about the mining industry. You all know. But then again, it is my duty to take you back to the initial period of mining industry. You are all aware that coal mining history in India dates back to 1774, when John Sumner and Hitley opened first mine in Raniganj coalfield. From that time till today, this industry has traveled a long distance. It has achieved a long milestone also, very creative milestone. You are also aware that this industry was under the private hands. Coal mining industry was in the private hands, and the condition of workers was really very pitiable. Taking that situation, Government of India has decided that this industry has to be nationalized. In 1971 and 1973, this industry has been nationalized. At that time, there were around 700 mines, 7 lakhs manpower, and the industry used to produce around 75 million tons of coal. From there, now we have come to a stage where we have got around 370 mines, 3 lakhs manpower, and we are producing more than 600 million tons a year. This year we are going to cross 600 million tons. By any standard, it is not a mean achievement. For a country like India, where there is no another alternative source of energy but coal, you all know that coal is the only fossil fuel which is in abundance in India. No other fuel, be it hydrocarbon, be it hydel, any form of energy, their resources are very limited. But coal is the only fossil fuel which has got huge resource, and as on today, we have got more than 315 billion tons of coal, and it is sufficient for more than 100 of years. You are all aware that your industry cannot be compared with any other industry. In any other industry, people work under the comfort of a boundary wall. But in case of coal industry, there is no boundary wall. Every year we are working on a moving front. And every year we are working under a very difficult and a very constrained situation. But then also, this industry is provided all the requirement which this country needs as far as energy security is concerned. To tell you the truth, Coal India Limited is the world's largest coal producing company. World's largest coal producing company. It provides 84% coal requirement of the country alone. 84%. Rest all others are providing only 16%. The second largest coal producing company of the world is Sinhua in China, which provides only 9 to 11% of the country's requirement. But your company is providing 84%. This company is doing a business of 1,40,000 crores per year. 1,40,000 crores per year. Around 8-10 years back, there was a saying that since Coal India is a monopoly, there is a lot of inefficiency, company is not good, unnecessarily it is using its monopolistic power. But then it was decided Coal India must show its strength and must prove itself. How you can prove yourself? Everybody thinks that he is the best. Everyone says that he is the best. But until and unless you go to the market, you don't know your worth. If you want to know your worth, you will have to go to the market. So for the first time, Coal India decided that it will go to the market. And in 2010, it went for an initial public offerings. And in the history of initial public offerings, Coal India share prices has created an history. We have gone for 15,000 crores. It was oversubscribed 15 times. 15 times. And in one particular day, the market capitalization of Coal India Limited was highest amongst all the company of India. By any standard, it was not a mean achievement. Coming from such a poor background, coming from such a poor culture, this industry used to be run by mafias and pahalwans. You must have seen the film Gang of Wasseypur. From that culture, we have come to the corporate culture. From that culture, we are providing sustainable growth. We are giving security to the nation as far as coal is concerned. You are all aware that any country cannot develop, cannot come to the category of developed country until and unless there is an energy security. If a country is secure for its requirement of energy, then only the country can come into the category of developed country. You are all aware that in 2000, only 43% population of India was exposed to electricity. They were getting the facility of electricity. Only 43% in 2000. And in 2019, almost 99% of the population is covered as far as electricity is concerned. Almost all villages have been electrified. And as far as requirement of energy is concerned, of all requirement, thermal power contributes around 72% of that energy requirement. And out of that 72%, 80% coal is provided by Coal India. So as far as electricity is concerned, at least Coal India can give an assurance to the country that whatever may the requirement of coal be, we will go forward and we will fulfill the requirement of the country. The point of concern that we are still importing around 200 million tons of coal worth rupees 1 lakh crores and more. Out of that, around 50 million tons is for steel making, that is coking coal, which India doesn't have, so we may agree. But as far as import of non-coking coal is concerned, that 150 million ton gap has to be fulfilled. If it can be fulfilled, it will generate additional resources for the country. It will generate additional employment for the country. And it is our responsibility, and it is you to see that this gap is bridged, and whatever is the requirement of the country, that requirement is met by country itself. And it poses a great responsibility on your shoulders. Tomorrow you are going to take part in this industry, and it is to your advantage, and it is to the advantage of the country that this gap must be fulfilled, that gap must be bridged. This country must be self-sufficient as far as coal production is concerned. You are all aware about the Coal India. I need not tell you much about Coal India Limited, but I must tell you one thing. Coal India still needs lot of good, talented and brilliant mining engineers. Of late, I am finding that that most of you are diverting towards IT industry or some other industry. Very few of you are interested in mining. Yes, mining is a tough job. Mining is a hard job. It doesn't give you a comfort of an AC room. But mining is not a profession, my dear. Mining is passion. If you have got that passion, then only you can become a brilliant or dedicated mining engineer. Don't treat as a profession, because you will have to face a lot of hurdles. You will have to face a lot of constraints. But then, out of that constraint, you should feel very happy that you are providing the energy security to the country. Just imagine one thing. Wherever you go, if in the remotest part of the country you see that a bulb is lighting, then you imagine some of your fellow worker is working 600 meters below the earth, or he is working somewhere at a temperature of 50 degrees centigrade in open cast mines, but he is providing comfort of that light or that air conditioner to all our fellow citizens. If you feel that a train is moving, fridge of your house is working, any electrical appliances is working, there is a light which is making India Prakashwan, then just imagine that coal is contributing more than 60% to it, and you are a part of it. You are a part of energy provider to the nation. No profession can provide you this type of satisfaction which coal industry can provide you. But yes, it is a tough job. You will have to prepare yourself. When we were undergraduates in Indian School of Mines, the school used to send us for a 2 months training in a mine. I don't know whether that situation is still continuing or not, but that training used to be very useful. It used to be very helpful in the context that it used to prepare yourself for the conditions to which you are going to adopt. Now I find that training program is also, is it continuing? If it is continuing, it is very good. It should continue. And I feel that you should get yourself prepared when you are in this college to face the life ahead, to face the challenges ahead. If you are better equipped, then only you can face that challenge. It's a tough job, no doubt, but it gives you lot of satisfaction, lots of satisfaction. I come to know that NCL has entered into an MOU with BHU for R&D work. I have also worked in coal CMPDI for 14 years. Once upon a time, I was heading the Science and Technology Department and Research and Technology Department. But I find that over the years, that research facility, that R&D program is not getting that much importance or that much attention which it should get. And in this context, institute like BHU has to play a major role. I must tell you that there is no dearth of money. We should only get good projects. We should only get projects which will be useful in actual life condition, not only for academics. Today we are living in a world where until and unless we prove yourself, nobody is going to help us. We will have to be self-sufficient. And for becoming self-sufficient, our R&D and S&T project should be useful as far as ground reality and field conditions are concerned, not only of academics nature. I request CMD NCL that he should take an active part in it, because NCL is very close to BHU. 4 hours, 5 hours journey is not a long distance. There should be a constant interaction between institute and the coal mines, so that students can come to know what type of problems mine is facing and in what way institute can solve them. So if that MOU has been entered, that MOU must be taken to its logical conclusion, and we must see some good R&D project. You are all aware that टाइम ऑफ कोल इज नॉट वेरी फार ऑफ विथ environmental conditions getting stringent, use of fossil fuel is going to be restricted. In coming days, you are all aware that power plant is not coming the way it was envisaged to come, but we have given an study, and in Vision 2030 document, we have come to a conclusion that around 1,300 million to 1,900 million ton coal will be needed by 2030. But after that, it will either be constant or it will be in the declining mode. So our first and prime most importance is to see how in environmentally sustainable measure we can use coal, or we can go for alternative use of coal. In this direction, Coal India has also taken some projects. We are going to manufacture urea from coal to gas, and from gas to urea. We have also undertaken projects from gas to urea, and three plants at Gorakhpur and Sindri and Barauni, urea from gas. And at Talcher, we are constructing a plant which will convert coal to gas and from gas to urea. We are also going to manufacture chemicals from coal. This diversification will be needed for future use. We are also trying to exploit coal-based methane to the extent possible. You know that in other countries, shale gas and CBM is used in high proportion for generation of electricity. We have identified around 10-15 blocks from where we will extract CBM, and that CBM will be used for commercial purposes. Friends, in 2024 to 2025, I would request Professor Sharma to take some good R&D and S&T project and to participate in some commercial activity also. Like, we are giving lot of job to outsider as far as coal quality is concerned. BHUIT can play a major role, and it can earn handsome revenue out of that. We are giving 8 rupees per ton for sampling purpose for analysis of coal. We are producing 600 million tons. So you can imagine the revenue. So IIT must plan, BHU also must plan to take part in such type of activity. Until and unless we are financially viable, we are financially competent, nobody is going to help us. The institute also makes some money, and for that institute must come into contact with the industry, and we are there to help you as far as giving the job on nomination basis is concerned and giving the job on a priority basis is concerned, because BHU itself commands a lot of respect in the industry. It's really a very proud moment for me, and I'm really thankful to Professor Sharma, who has given me an opportunity to come in front of you and to speak a few words. I think I have spoken enough, but I will invite every one of you, if you have any doubt, if you want to ask anything, if you want to question anything, you are free to do that. I have still got half an hour time with me, but I must tell you one thing. Each one of you is competent to hold the highest position in the country as far as coal mining is concerned. Please try to encash that opportunity. God is very kind to you people that you are studying in such a prestigious institute. Every student is not that lucky to get admission in BHU. We got independence in 1947. But today also, there are 200 million people who are not getting 2 square meals a day. There are 300 million people who still do not have the facility of clean water, who do not have the facility of medical health. So it is our responsibility, it is our moral duty to see that each and every citizen of India must get the basic minimum. And to give them that basic minimum, it poses a huge responsibility on you also. Please try to help those who are not as lucky as you are. And whenever you take a decision, whenever you do something, please keep in the back of your mind that whether this decision, where this action is going to help the man who is sitting at the corner of the country. If it is going to help them, please go ahead and take the decision. And always think that your country is above everything. We must act in a befitting manner to take India in the most developed country stature. You are all aware that in 2030, India is going to be the third largest economy with a GDP of around $10 trillion. From presently $3 trillion, it will exceed $10 trillion. So there is a huge growth potential. We should act fast, we should act humanely, and we should see that this country gets what it deserves. This country used to be the Sone Ki Lanka. Doodh aur dahi ki nadiyan behti thi yahan. But now, that lost glory has to be retrieved. We must take this country forward. Lot of work has been done. Lot of work still is to be done. And we will see to it how we can achieve that goal, which has been envisioned by our great leader like Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru. We should try to create a conducive condition where all should grow, all should develop, and this country should come in the forefront of a developed country. As far as your industry is concerned, when I say your industry, I mean coal mining industry. It is contributing a major chunk of GDP. It is contributing to major employment. So we must see that this industry must prosper to give a sustainability to this country. As far as Coal India is concerned, we will try to see that whatever could be done for the country, be it in the case of coal production, or whether it is a corporate social responsibility, whether it is contributing towards research and development activity, we are open to it. And we are taking Kasi also. You must have heard that Coal India has taken a renovation program for some of the ghats of the Kasi. We will go for that also. And we will go extra mile to see that your institute flourishes like anything and your institute become one of the top institute of the world as far as the study of mining engineering is concerned. I once again thank the entire faculty of Mining Engineering Department of VHUIT, and I am most thankful to my young friends who have taken pen, and this hall is full. It gives me a lot of satisfaction that my younger generation is also taking interest in listening to their seniors. And if you try to follow those guidelines, I am very sure you will get success as much as you need. Thank you. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.